Love has the power to change someone's day, to lift someone's heart, to comfort someone's soul. Love is a language that everybody speaks, men and women, young and old, rich and poor. Love is the character of God, who loved us before we loved Him, who loved us so we could love one another. Love is not just a feeling, it's a commitment. Not just an emotion, it's a decision. Love is about giving, not getting. Jesus said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." This is the power of love.
Welcome to worship this morning. A couple of days from now will be Valentine's Day. So, of course, we need to turn our hearts, our attention to the concept of love. Let's stand together and say this scripture for our call to worship. I know you know it off by heart. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believed in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Whoever believes in him. Love is a decision, and God decided that you were worth everything.
Our God,
He's our God. And yet, Jesus said that where two or three are gathered, there am I in their midst. Our God is not some faraway God looking down on us. Our God came down to live with us, and now in us, He is a God of relationships. So this Valentine's Day, when you are celebrating earthly relationships, how about starting with the perfect example, God Himself? And if you don't have a relationship with Him, how about starting with getting one? Here is love. And it is vast. And it is for you. God's love and in God's power, He gives us love. Maybe this Valentine's Day is not your favorite holiday, your favorite day, because you have relationships that are broken. Maybe there is someone that you have hard feelings towards, or someone that you have no feelings towards because you have shunned them, turned them out of your life. Before Valentine's Day comes, why not pray about those relationships and ask God to give you, with his power, the love to make the first gesture of restoration and reconciliation. Your responsibility is the first gesture. Do not feel guilty if it is not reciprocated. But reach out, for I believe that more relationships are mended than broken when, in the power of God, we reach out. I pray for you today. You know, again and anew and afresh, the power of God's love in your life.
Rebuild, flowing from So if you want to turn with me in your Bibles to the first chapter of the Gospel of John, we're continuing along there, and we've been, I know you think I'm stuck here, but we're not. We have, though we do have one more Sunday that we're going to look at this particular passage of Scripture. But turn with me to the Scriptures as I open up my tablet here. And let's read what the Bible has to say. And today I'm going to read from the NIV version of this particular passage. So this is John denying him being the Messiah. Now this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. So see this picture, these priests, these religious leaders of their time came and asked him who he was. But he did not fail to confess, but confess freely, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him then, "Who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" And finally, John replied, "In the words of Isaiah the prophet, I am the voice of the one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the pathway for the Lord." Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father God, we thank you again for your word today. We thank you that we can learn from the life of John the Baptist, O Lord. And we also know that it's been confusing as we read the Gospel of John and we talk about the Apostle John who wrote this, and yet we're also talking about John the Baptist, the forerunner to Jesus Christ, and what we learn from what and how John lived his life, who he was. So Father, again, I pray that you would open our eyes, that not only do we learn the facts of this passage, O Lord, but we also learn how it applies to us. That ultimately we, Lord, can answer that question, who we are. Father, I pray this, and I pray that you'll give me the right words today, and I pray it all in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. So over the last number of weeks, I guess 3 weeks prior here, we have been looking at what John knew about himself. We talked about the fact that John knew who he was, and that he came as a man sent by God to be the witness to the light, which is Jesus Christ. We talked about that he was a voice of one crying in the desert or the wilderness, and we'll talk about a little bit more about that little part. We talked last week about John the Baptizer, and we talked about baptism. We talked about the Jewish kind of baptism, the John's baptism, and other types of baptism to today, our believer's baptism, what we believe Jesus taught us to do and to practice in believer's baptism. We come to the next part. So John knew who he was. But he also, if you're reading this passage and think about it, he knew who he wasn't. John knew who he wasn't. That may be just as important and maybe more important to us. This may be one of the secrets of John's greatness, because he knew who he wasn't. He didn't put on pretensions. John in 1:23, this delegation comes, we just read, out to see John the Baptist. And they had heard about John and had been meeting with him out there. They'd been talking to him. They wondered what was going on. What is it that's happening here? Why are these crowds flocking to see John? It was the Levites, it was the Pharisees that were coming, the priests. That's who was heading out here to see John. And the question may be, why were they curious? Did they want to have faith in John? Or were they afraid of John the Baptist? You see, John the Baptist was preaching. And to those kinds of people, he preached. He got up one day with a sermon and said to them, you bunch of snakes, or vipers, if you're reading, I think, in the King James Version. He started out the sermon that way. Could you imagine this group of leaders, religious leaders, and he comes to them and says, you group of snakes? That was a great way, right, to win friends and influence people. They were scared of John. They were scared to death of a false Messiah being out there. That's what they were scared of. In fact, these men, these priests, these Levites, not necessarily all Jews, but these people, these priests, these Levites, were afraid that someone might be a false Messiah. Same we might be today. But they were so afraid, of course, that they missed the true Messiah, which was right there. They missed Jesus. They were so cynical, they were so negative thinking, that they couldn't see the truth when it came, when it was right there in front of them. You see, there's some application of that for our lives. Every once in a while, as John 1:19-24, they have this discussion with John the Baptist, what we read today. Who do you say that you are? And then they go through this list of things, right? Are you the Christ? And of course, John immediately says, I'm not the Christ. In verse 20, he did not fail to confess, it says, but he confessed freely, I am not the Christ. And of course, you know why John the Apostle wrote it that way. There were people who that day who were trying to worship John the Baptist. And of course, John was not wanting to be worshipped. So when John wrote this book, he said, get this real clear. John the Baptist was not Christ. He's not the promised one. There was a lot of talk in those days about the promised one coming real soon. A lot like our day today, or the world we live in. They wanted it, and they were testing John. Are you the Messiah? Are you the promised one of God who's going to come and set us free? And of course, John said, I am not. No, I'm not. Well, then they say, are you Elijah? And he said, what? I am not. In Micah 4:5, in the last book of the Old Testament, you know how interested we are in Revelations. Well, the last book, which is the last book of the New Testaments, they were interested in the last book of the Old Testament. Of course, the New Testament isn't even written. And Malachi, they read this book, and in chapter 4, verse 5, it says, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and terrifying day of the Lord's judging. Before the Lord comes, before the Messiah comes, Elijah's going to come, the prophet. Now remember that Elijah, the prophet of the Old Testament, the prophet who worked all of those miracles and stuff that Elijah did, he's going to come back. Are you Elijah? And of course, John the Baptist says, no, I'm not. I'm not Elijah. Now, this becomes real interesting when we look at Matthew chapter 17, verses 12 to 13, because Jesus said, but I tell you, Elijah has already come, and they did not recognize him, but they had done to him everything they wished. In the same way, the Son of Man is going to suffer at their hands. Then the disciples understood that he was talking to them about John the Baptist. So we tend to get confused here, don't we? We get confused about this because here's John the Baptist saying, well, I'm not Elijah. And Jesus saying, yes, he is Elijah. Is a little bit confusing, isn't it? It's sometimes where people reading scripture get confused. John the Baptist is a mere human man, says, no, I'm not. And Jesus, the Son of God, of all eternity, says, yes, he is. Now, who do you think is right here? Who do you think is right? Well, it's pretty simple. John is and was a man, and he could be wrong. And Jesus said he is Elijah. And Jesus, as we talked about in the very first part of this book of John, is God. We learn that he is God. So to John's credit, there's more behind it than that. That's still confusing you, I'm sure. Because John the Baptist knew the kind of question that they were actually asking him. They expected a certain kind of Elijah. They expected a literal Elijah to rise from the grave and come back. They expected a living, walking Elijah, reincarnated. Just like they expected the Messiah when he came to overthrow the Roman Empire. And they were all wrong about these things. Of course, Jesus didn't come back as a triumphant king that with armies and horses to get rid of the... He will in the second coming, as we're told, but not in the first coming of the Lord. So when they said, are you Elijah, to John? To John's credit, he was really answering the question the way they were asking it. He was saying, no, I'm not the reincarnation of Elijah. That's not who I am. In fact, at John's birth, you really find the answer to all of this. And it's written in Luke 1:17, when the prophecies came of who John the Baptist would be, the angel tells them, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah. That makes it clear. It's the same kind of spirit and the same kind of power of Elijah, but it's not Elijah. It's not that reincarnated being that he came back. The Bible tells us that John was filled with the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and while he was in his mother's womb, he was filled with the Spirit. And that's pretty exciting, isn't it? Have a kid filled with the Holy Spirit when he's in the womb. He came in the Spirit, and he came in the power of Elijah. But he wasn't a literal Elijah. He was figurative, I guess, would be the word to use here. So Jesus said, he is the one. John had said, I am not what you think. But Jesus said, he is the forerunner that was prophesied. So he is the Elijah that was prophesied. Then they said, are you the prophet? Well, John said, no. You can see things are getting shorter, his answers, right? Every step here, he get shorter. I'm sure he's getting a little upset with these people who should actually know better. They should have known. His answers are getting blunt. I am not the Christ. Are you Elijah? I am not. Are you the prophet? No. Shorter, shorter, and shorter, right? You know who the prophet was that was they were talking about. Moses had talked about it in Deuteronomy 18:15. The Lord will rise up for you prophet like me from among your own brothers. You must listen to him. The prophet that was talked about a lot by the Jews. They talked about this prophet. They didn't understand, though, that this prophet was Jesus. This prophet was the Messiah that was being talked about. They thought it was someone different, and Jesus is actually the fulfillment of this particular prophecy. So when they asked John, "Are you the prophet?" he said real clear, "No, I'm not the prophet. I'm not the Messiah again." One of the most crucial questions that any of us can ask ourselves. Let me read this again. One of the most crucial questions any of us are going to have to face in our lives is found in this verse 22. Finally, they said just simply three-word question to him. Who are you? And that's a crucial question. Who are you? You know, when God asked that of me, when others asked that of me, when my family asked that of me, who are you? This is a crucial question. Crucial point in the life of John. It's a crucial point in all of our lives when we face it. Who are we? Who are you? Just think of all that he could have said. Look at my ancestors. My father was Zacharias, who was a priest. I've got the same kind of ancestry as you guys. But he didn't say that, did he? Who are you? He could have said, I was filled with the Holy Spirit in my mother's womb. Can you match anything like that? He could have challenged them. He could have pointed to his success. I'm the baptizer out here in the desert, and hundreds of thousands of people are flocking to me to be baptized. He could have pointed out his great sacrifice, that who am I? I'm the guy out here having to eat locusts and wild honey and wear a camel's hair skin as clothing. But what does he say? How does he answer that question? I'm a voice. Just a voice crying out in the wilderness. In light of the great ways that God used this man, the fact that he was the greatest one who lived up until that time, according to the words of Jesus, he had an incredible humility about him in his life, didn't he? His choice was to say, I'm just a voice. That's what I am. When I was doing my research on this passage of scripture, I read somebody who wrote this. He said, John had a very specific and important God-given role in history. This encourages me, but I know in my heart that no matter how simple or small or large or symbolic, he has a specific purpose for me as well. And he'll always be with me to see that his will is accomplished. Do you know that? Who are you? Do you know who you are? We said John knew who he was. We're saying today he knew who he wasn't. So he's very comfortable in himself. We need to ask ourselves as we look at John the Baptist and the people coming out to say, who are you? And all of us need to ask ourselves, am I living my life in such a way that people look at my life and they say, who are you? Is your life different than the world that we live in? We just spent time praying for this world that's falling apart in a lot of ways. And what do you believe? Why is it making a difference in your life? Are people asking you that question? Or are you kind of walking through this life ducking that question? You don't want people to ask. So you keep your mouth zipped up when things are falling apart around you and when people are spouting things that are not of God. You know, none of us can be perfect. I can't, you can't. But we can be growing and we can be different in this world and we can make a difference in this world. John was different and John made a difference. I said he was that voice calling in the wilderness, pointing to Jesus Christ. We talked about that a few weeks ago. He wasn't perfect, but he was certainly different because of his faith. Because of that, they went out to the desert and said, who are you? People came out to see him and asked, who are you? He didn't have to go to them. They didn't summon him to come to me. They went to him. The point is, he knew he wasn't who he wasn't. And he expressed it in a incredibly humble manner. When you get asked that question, can you express it in an incredibly humble manner? Or are you going to talk about being the son of this or son of that? I mean, I could stand here and say, what am I, great-grandson of a Baptist preacher and a grandson of one? And oh, I guess I missed a great. It's a great-great-grandson, too. Had some Methodist preachers in my background, but none of that matters. It's who am I in Christ? And the same is with you. Who are you in Christ? I know for a fact God has given you incredible gifts. You may not always feel that way, but you should. But be humble in it. Remember where those gifts come from. They come from God. They come from the Spirit that lives within each and every Christian. My question this morning would be, have you truly surrendered to Jesus? Because it's got to be 100%, people. Not just part of you. You can't work your way into heaven. So many Christians after they've given their heart to Jesus, try to work their way into heaven or try to pay him back for the gift. I can't pay God back for the gift of Jesus. You can't. All I can do is humbly use the gifts and the abilities that God has given me and express who I am in Christ. So who are you? Who are you? It's a good question to ponder today and this whole week. Who are you? Are you a son of the living God? Are you a brother to Jesus Christ? Are you part of his creation or have you turned your back on him? Who are you? Till you can answer that question, you can't live, really. John was important because he could answer who he was and who he wasn't. He was also important because he knew who Jesus was. And next week, we're going to look at that as we conclude this section on John the Baptist. It'll be appropriate, you'll see, as we come to the baptismal waters, what we're going to talk on next week. John knew who Jesus was. Do you know who Jesus is? Do you know that Jesus is the Messiah? Or are you still waiting for the Messiah? Or are you still waiting for a God that's going to make everything perfect for you all of a sudden right now? He's going to give you diamonds and gold and as the name it and claim it people want to talk about out there, because he's not. That's not God. The gifts that we get, the treasures we get, is the life that's in store for us, the life that Betty's dad is now knowing in heaven. Experiencing his hard work here as he shared the gospel of Jesus over the years. Answer the question for yourself. Who are you? Let's bow our heads in prayer. Great God in heaven, you are the Almighty. You are the creator and the sustainer of all that there is. And Father God, as we bow our heads before you and as a congregation, I pray that each one of us will take the opportunity to search our hearts, our lives, and that we'll ask the question, do we know who we are? Are we aware of who we are and who we're not? And if we can answer that, Lord, I fully believe people will come to us and we can be that voice in the wilderness pointing to the way of the Lord. But Father, first of all, speak to our hearts. Open us up to listen to that voice. Help us to realize who we are in Christ. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask the praise team to come and close us in song today.
Stand and sing together. When it was impressed upon me, this song to close the service, of course, I had no idea that our family, our church family, would be touched by the passing of someone else. But as John the Baptist knew who he was and who he was not, he chose a life to live for truth. Capital T truth, Jesus Christ. When you ponder the question, who am I? You may have a wonderful heritage. You may have great achievements. And all those things that you have done are wonderful and need to be acknowledged and need to be celebrated. But when we pass through the veil, we leave them behind. Only one thing matters.
When it's all been said and done, there is just one thing that matters. Did I do my best to live for truth? Did I live my life for you? When it's all
Father God, as we leave this place of worship today, may your Spirit guide us and direct our hearts from this moment forward, forevermore, that we will be seen following you, O Lord God. That when it's all been said and done, you will say, "Good, my good and faithful servant." Father, help us to be your servants, O Lord, as we go forth into this world today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless.